as an oncology advisor. That's been trained by the world's best oncologists, the 20 best centers in the world, Memorial Sloan Kettering, the Cancer Institute, clinical trial matching, Mayo Clinic, genomic sequencing, Illumina, as well as Quest, available to, in the United States, really 70% of all patients that have cancer. So you get this reach and when those principles are followed. And that, to me, I think is the great promise. And on one hand, we'll do everyday things, help teachers teach better. On the other hand, the reason this is worth fighting so strongly to have it roll out right is you can really solve problems. I mean, India has one oncologist for 1,600 patients. You'll never get there, as you would say, without this kind of technology. Yeah.
Satya, you know, you have built really a wonderful business model around taking complex, cutting-edge technology that, frankly, was available only to the few and giving the ability for many to access it. Talk a little bit about, you know, the AI approach, the cognitive approach, and really the democratization that you're leading at Microsoft, and to what extent that democratization creates, again, the opportunity for all to participate in what AI's promise is.
Yeah, I mean, for us, I always think about our sense of purpose, our sense of identity, in some sense, starts with the first product that Microsoft created, which was the basic interpreter for the Altair. So I always ask myself, what's the moral equivalent of that in this AI world? And that's really what informs, at least, our efforts. We obviously build a bunch of AI services. Take Skype Translate, which you referenced in the beginning, which is pretty magical. In fact, recently we had 100 people talking 10 different languages simultaneously being able to communicate with each other. Or the personal digital assistant, Cortana. I had sent a piece of email in December saying I'll follow up with two people in January, and lo and behold, comes January, and I'm reminded because of a commitment I made in email. These are the everyday tools that we want to build. But the key for me, though, is not any one tool we build, but it's the technology underneath it. How do we make it broadly accessible? Very much like how Jeannie was talking about, because that's, I think, really the true benefit of AI. So in our case, one of the things that inspires me is the state I was born in India and the state I now live in the United States, both are using statistical machine learning to be able to improve the high school outcomes and use the scarce state resources smartly. Now, that to me is democratizing AI, putting it in the hands of school administrators everywhere. It is about putting AI tools in the hands of oncologists and radiologists in Cambridge, so that they can use the cutting-edge object recognition technology to be able to not only do early detections of tumors, but also to predict tumor growth so that the right regimen can be applied. It is about being able to pick examples like that in nonprofit or in public sector, but not just stopping there. For example, one of the things that has truly been amazing to see is how individuals with the right tools can make a difference. There's this one gentleman out of our Cambridge office who's visually impaired. He decided that, look, we have some real breakthroughs in the last year, or especially around perception and object recognition and computer vision. So he's building glasses for anyone with visual impairment to be able to recognize not only people, but their emotion in real time. That, to me, is democratizing AI. But it's also to large businesses. So it's not just about these examples. So if it could be a bank that is able to give credit to the unbankable, more so. In fact, there's a startup in Kenya that was able to take essentially their solar grid, which is in the cloud, and predict, based on $1 per day incomes, credit rating. So they've created a credit rating where none existed before. Or Rolls-Royce that's creating an airline efficiency system. Or Volvo doing driver safety. In fact, before autonomous driving, the key thing is let's not have distracted drivers. And so Volvo is using computer vision to make sure that you don't have distracted driving. or Cortana itself, our agent finding its way into Nissan cars or what have you. So there are many, many of these examples. And to me, the key right now in this next phase of AI is how do we put tools so that others can create intelligence in every walk of life?
Yeah, Satya, one of the questions, a little bit of a follow-up, then we'll go to Joy, is when you think about these tools, what are the governing principles around these tools? How, you know, you can't just give these tools to everyone, or can you? And to what extent can those tools ultimately, for the greater good, be weaponized for not so good? Tell us a little bit about what some of those principles are and how do you actually guide a business that is a tool provider so that you're actually on the right side of call it justice in this context.
Yeah, that's a great set of questions. I mean, Jeannie started addressing some of these things, which is what are the principles? So let's start with sort of even the pragmatics. I think Joy, I'm sure, will talk more about even the ethics of it. But the way I came at it was to say, let's first start with, just like good designers in the past, like take user experience. We've had design guidelines. Before we get into the ethics, the law, let's start even with a set of pragmatic principles that can guide AI creation for us or anyone else using the toolkit. Mm-hmm. So one of the first things we talked about was, I wrote a piece, I think, 6-7 months ago, where I said, the first thing is let's make, as Microsoft, a decision that we are not trying to create AI, which, of course, learns like humans, but is in purpose. Its purpose is to help humans do what they do better. So it's augmentation versus replacement. That's a design choice. I actually think that you can, in fact, come at it and say, well, replacement is the goal, or you can say augmentation is the goal. In our case, I want us to make the decision that it's augmentation.
Right. One of the challenges with that, though, is who is making that design choice? And this is what leads to Joy, right? I look at you, as I call the wellspring from which most of our AI designers come, in some respects. You get an opportunity to meet these young minds, teach these young minds. And so we need to understand who are these folks, what's their demographic, where did they come from, and how do we now help them understand the importance beyond this being a technology, but the importance to society and their role in shaping the ethics and the governance of this technology?
So I will say, I'm at the Media Lab, which is where some of the oddballs who are interested in AI hang out. And we have a computer science and artificial intelligence lab, which is where they make a lot of the core work. And in fact, I think most of the real research now is going on in industry. I mean, kind of, it's a historical moment. I mean, mostly because you pay and provide these people the resources. So it's not necessarily being driven by academia, but they usually come through academia. And this will offend some people, but and I want to just say this kind of as a generalization, but I think that people who are very focused and very good at computer science and AI tend to be the ones that don't like the messiness of the real world. They like the control of the computer. They like to be able to sort of be methodical and think in numbers and complexity in a machine. So sort of by definition, you usually don't get the traditional liberal arts, philosophy types. Now you have those, they're there on the edges. And also because it's social. The way you get into computers is because your friends are into computers, which is generally white men. Mm-hmm. And so when you look at the demographic across Silicon Valley, you see a lot of white men. So one of our researchers, Joy Winnie, she's an African-American woman, and she discovered that in the core libraries for face recognition, dark faces don't show up. And these libraries are used in many of the products that you have. And if you're an African-American person, you get in front of it, it won't recognize your face. And so she discovered it because probably there was no one who had a dark face in the place where they were building and testing it. And so one of the risks that we have of the lack of diversity of the engineers is that it's non-intuitive which questions you should be asking. And even if you have the design guidelines, some of this stuff is kind of field decision. Right. And I think IBM and Microsoft are both doing a very good job of working with people in the field. But I do think one thing that we need to think about, and this is a very much a Media Lab point of view, is that when the people who are actually doing the work actually create the tools, you get much better tools. So like television and newspapers, the creators of the tools and the users sort of separated so that the evolution slowed down.
Right.
But if you look at video games, where the creators were into the technology, they went from coin-op to CD to online, and you saw a continuing business model and technology evolution. So right now, what I'm looking for from both of you guys is, and all of you guys, is when VisiCalc came out and introduced a spreadsheet, it was a runaway success, not because it solved the accounting problems. It gave the accountants a tool to express their creativity on a machine. And one of that, we don't have that yet. AI is still somewhat of a bespoke art where you have a super duper engineer who listens to the customer, tries to understand, but the customer can't imagine the tool yet because it's too difficult. And I think whether we're talking about ethics or whether we're talking about the workforce, one of the key things that I'd love the both of you to think about is instead of delivering a solution, which is the first phase of getting people excited about it, I think you need to integrate the lawyers and the ethicists and the customer into actually getting an intuitive understanding of the tool. I think that's important.
Jenny, absolutely interested in hearing your point of view on this. You know, you engage with some of the largest corporations on the planet who are going through this digital transformation, embracing AI. How are they embracing it? And do you guys provide governing principles for them, or do you basically provide the tool and let them come up with the right principles?
This is a very, very important point in a learning, I think. So anyone in this field, this is built for the people, by the people, with the people, if you want to say it that way. And my experience on all of these, whether it was doctors, underwriters, teachers with best lesson plan, that work must be done with them. We've tried it the other way. It does not work, just as you described it. And I think this is a really critical, critical point. And so when you mentioned that point about principles, right, and Satya started, this first principle, which I believe strongly, is that you must have the right purpose for these tools as we build them. Mm-hmm. And purpose means it is augment and in service of. And particularly because there's so much fear about jobs, and we'll come back to that, and job replacement and the like. But the odds are there are some jobs that will wholly be replaced by automation, but most of us will be working with these systems, is how most of its interaction will be. And so you being clear on your purpose. But the second one on this transparency, if anyone's to trust these systems, as you said, I don't see a picture. You must be clear, I believe, as you build these with when. So if someone's using a system, tell them that's artificial intelligence. Mm-hmm. When it's being used. The second thing we've been very clear is that tell them how it got trained. This is probably the most important point, which is, was it trained by experts? Was it trained in a way that I can trust what these sources are, and what data was used to train this? Because we're going to end in a world, these can be trained very differently. And back to that point about being in purpose of, the human needs to remain in control of these systems, knowing it can always, if I can put that bluntly, pull the plug.
Right.
The human is in control, is the purpose. The second one is that this point of when is it used, what, where, how was it trained, what data? And then who owns that insight is the second principle. And that third principle is, I want to come back to it, but I also want to get our friend here, is skills.
Jump in and ask one question, though, about pulling the plug.
Yeah.
Because if you have an autopilot on a plane.
Yes.
And you're not allowed to overrule it now. Or if you have it's kind of hard to pull the plug once it's in a mission-critical role.
I mean that in a slightly different way. And I think this is an important point. Because there's a lot of talk of, can they completely replace what we do as humans? And both by our principles, as well as the state of science, they are not going to have this self-awareness, consciousness. That isn't the case, right? So I mean it in that context that you're able to.
Yeah. Ron, let's talk, Ron. You're an entrepreneur. You've built this wonderful business. It is, you know, like I said, you've bet the farm to some degree on inputs from over 100,000 plus doctors, and there is no more complex, at least today, diagnostic environment than healthcare. Talk a little bit about the vision, how you're going to leverage AI, and talk a little bit about, you know, how you think about managing, ultimately, the biases, the treatment, the self-regulation for the doctors who are inputting, for those of us who used to get our medical degrees on Google when we had a sniffle, right? So tell us a little bit about how this works now.
Absolutely. So to Jeannie's point, right? So, yes, we start with doctors, but we actually are here to serve patients and serve use cases, right? So